Well, I'll call the Monday, August 3rd, 2015 regular meeting of the Eugene Planning Commission to order. And as is our custom, we reserve a few minutes at the beginning of each meeting for public comment, but having checked with the public, no one wishes to comment. And so with that, we will move on to Terry and Envision Eugene Comprehensive Plan.
Great, thank you. So we're here to talk about the comprehensive plan. I brought a short presentation, but really my hope today is to walk you through the materials that are in your packet. So the slides are kind of a snapshot of what's in your packet for the benefit of those in the room and those who might be watching online.
You can get right into the mic. I'm not hearing you real well. Are you hearing her okay? Okay. Then maybe it's just me.
Okay. Right. I'll just try to speak up.
Okay.
So as you know, we're working towards adoption of an Envision Eugene plan that has four components. And so that's the first thing, is that part one through four are listed on the slide here, community vision, comprehensive plan, an urban form and community design plan, and an implementation and monitoring plan. And those four all work together. In your packet, you have this diagram, which shows how the four relate to each other and what's inside of each of these documents. The vision really tells the story of Envision Eugene and ties us back to the pillars. The comprehensive plan is our regulatory component. It includes all of our state-required goals and policies related to growth management. The urban form plan is an illustrative and inspirational component that is non-regulatory and will include the community design handbook. And then the implementation component links our goals to strategies and actions and a detailed monitoring plan that you've recently heard an update on. Just to give you a status update on the three components other than the comprehensive plan, the vision is really pulling forward the work from the recommendation that was published in 2012. So staff is still working on this and will bring you a refined update on this part, this component, in September. And also provide the City Council with an update, because this is really the component of the plan that sets the framework for the policies that they will be asked to adopt. Any questions on that?
Well, on the if we can ask on the separate parts.
Yeah, how would you like just questions as we go along? Keep it informal?
This is the only part where I talk about the vision, so okay. If there's a question about that.
So my only question is, there were some areas that weren't covered very well in the community vision. One of the areas I would mention that keeps getting mentioned to me from the Historic Review Board is that you can search the entire document, and I think you find the word historic once in the document. So I'm just wondering about updates that would sort of fill in some gaps maybe or whatever.
Sure.
Related to that in the vision, because right now if you just pull the existing document in, you know, it's like historic preservation doesn't exist.
That's a great thing for us to keep in mind.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. So the third component, urban form and community design, as I said, is the non-regulatory component. This is also in refinement. You've seen this document before. You've seen kind of previews of it. We're intending to have an open house on it later in September and then bring it back to you for an update in October. Any questions about the urban form component and community design handbook? Okay. And then as far as implementation and monitoring, again, non-regulatory, but this is really where we get to have an action plan of items that we're moving forward to implement the plan. You heard an update on the growth monitoring program from Heather O'Donnell on June 22nd. That work is continuing to be refined through the technical resource group, and they have an upcoming meeting on that topic in September, and we anticipate that this will also be brought back to you in October. Questions on that piece? Okay. So diving more into the comprehensive plan, this is our regulatory plan. We currently operate under the Metro Plan as our regulatory policy document. And the Eugene Comprehensive Plan will extract portions from the Metro Plan and bring forward other items that are part of the Envision Eugene recommendation. We're going to today discuss the first couple of chapters, Chapter 1 and Chapter 3. And then you'll see us again in later August to talk about a public involvement strategy for adoption of the comprehensive plan and the greater urban growth boundary. Then in September, we're going to be scheduling an intercommission workshop. And the concept is still in the planning stages, but this would be where our planning commission subcommittee and really any interested planning commissioners would come together with housing policy board members, historic review board members, sustainability commission, human rights commission, and probably the bicycle and pedestrian advisory committee. So other related commissions and boards would come together to have a workshop on the comprehensive plan. So that's still in the planning stages, but something I think will help give the comprehensive plan a well-rounded well-rounded attention from other departments across the city besides planning. Yeah.
As listed here, is that the sequence that they'll follow? I would think that you would do 2, 4, and 9 and then have the commission workshop. Mm-hmm.
We will have drafts of those.
Oh, okay.
But we won't be ready to bring those back to the full commission until later in September.
So there will be drafts at that workshop.
Yeah. Okay, so later in September, we bring the other chapters that are in progress, 2, 4, and 9. Those are compact development, housing, and administration implementation. And I'm also hoping to schedule an update for you on the transportation chapter from Public Works and the process that's parallel to Envision Eugene. And then again, hold maybe at the same time a community event about the comprehensive plan along with the community design handbook. Okay, any questions about those upcoming dates? We're going to get more into the content. The documents that are in your packet are the comp plan outline and a table of contents, an introduction to the goals and policies, and then drafts of chapter 1 and 3. So I'd like to just take these one at a time and see if you have any questions about these. I put up on the screen a snapshot of what this looks like. I don't expect you to be able to read it, but this is what it looks like in your packet as far as the outline of the plan. Any questions about what's part of phase one or the comp plan as a whole? So it's going to be a quick meeting.
Oh, no.
We'll get there. Okay. Okay. Then we'll move on to the next one. So the table of contents is a much lengthier document, and the idea behind this was to give you an idea of where different policy items will be addressed in the comprehensive plan. So this became evident as a need when we were meeting as a subcommittee and talking about the draft compact development chapter, and things came up around livability and economic development, and so we thought it would be helpful to put together a table of contents that goes through the whole plan and talks about the goal headings and policy headings for those different chapters. Any questions on this or discussion? Did it make sense? Was it a useful outline?
Yes.
Okay.
Good.
Yes, so.
All right.
Okay.
I just have one question. So you have, we're covering 1 and 3 now, and then 2, 4, and 9 are in September. That leaves out a bunch of other chapters. So when will those be covered?
Those are not part of the adoption package with the urban growth boundary. We're going to have additional time and effort put behind those chapters, 5, 6, and 7, which cover livability and natural resources and public facilities. They're not required to be adopted at the same time as the urban growth boundary, but we've got them going over a portion of the next year to complete those with adequate staff and community process.
And what about Chapter 8?
Chapter 8, I hope to have an update from Public Works soon. It will be part of the adoption package.
Okay, that's what I was, because I just didn't, I was just trying to fill in the missing numbers.
Yes.
Sorry, I should be speaking into the
microphone.
That's
okay, and that's transportation. That's critical.
Harry, I noticed in mine, Chapter 4 housing was also in blue rather than black.
And was that just a, is that just an oversight? Because I'm assuming that's in this first.
It is. That's probably because it was in blue prior to council making the decision on the urban growth boundary.
Got it.
To advance that portion. So we'll make that update.
And in our packet, chapters 4, 5, 6, and 7 were in blue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, definitely. But 5, 6, and 7 are not...
Part of phase 2.
They're part of phase 2. Got it. Okay.
So, Terry, what are the points of review that are going to occur on Chapter 8?
That's a good question. I know that there's a draft of the entire transportation system plan, either for internal or external review. Alyssa, do you know what the status is?
I tried to find it, and I couldn't find it on the website.
It's getting prepared for external review, and you were on the transportation CRB, so I think that
you'll be getting it.
Gets a take a look at that. So.
Because I guess, as you know, I ended up with a lot of questions related to this. I don't know if this is the appropriate time to talk about that or let it go for now.
Well, I think for now we're in communication with Public Works about how to bring the Planning Commission and the broader community along on that chapter. But I don't have the answers right now as far as the next steps. I think if you have things you want to make sure that we cover,
bring it up.
Okay, if now's the time.
More about content or about kind of process?
Well, some things I raised questions, and I would be a page 7, the first bullet above pedestrian policies, defer road rate improvements that increase motor vehicle capacity until existing constraints can be overcome. What does that mean?
Yeah, that's what I saw too.
I mean, you use a word like constraints, kind of, and it's out there dangling. And so you're saying defer road improvements, okay, but then something is vague until existing constraints, and I don't understand what are you tying that to? So that'd be a question I have, and I'm not expecting you to have all the answers.
Oh, great. I'll note that down.
Support higher speed under rail freight and pipeline. I'm just going to raise support higher speed passenger rail service. And, you know, that's a very broad, we can all say we support it. But, you know, and once again, I would hope that you're going to talk about how you would support that, mm-hmm. what kind of actions the city would be taking. I presume mostly that would be lobbying in some form or another at the state. Create a railroad quiet zone. Of course, that's a big hot topic right now. And hopefully that'll get more clarity in the document. Under cost effectiveness policies, this is under cost effectiveness, prioritize active transportation options over parking. And of course, you know, we all agree that we need to have better and more walkable areas and safer areas. Once again, I think that I'm not sure how this relates to cost effectiveness.
Okay. Right. Just a quick note about this. This is a generalized outline. I'm looking over at Sarah because she helped put this together.
Well, I'm just throwing these out, so hopefully, you know, these will be questions or things you guys can remark to. Under finance policies, logical phased jurisdictional transfer of roads and highways. I don't know what that means. I think what I'm assuming that means is you're trying to take some state highways back into city jurisdiction.
Or county facilities.
Or county jurisdiction.
Mm-hmm.
Or trying to bring them back and make them less, so the city can take control of those.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I assume that means, but it's not clear from that. And I'll stop for now.
Okay, thanks. Okay. We'll pass those on.
Yeah.
I guess just kind of while we're talking about the transportation policy, and I know that staff has worked really hard on this, I just kind of wanted to discuss what I see to be as a bit of a contradiction. So under specific policies on page 6, you have a complete streets policy, But on page 7, then you have your second bullet point is to use motor vehicle level of service standards. And I know that a lot of other cities, including San Luis Obispo and Portland, have switched to multimodal level of service standards. Some cities refer to them as urban level of service standards. My question is, if we are really optimizing complete streets as a policy, why are we sticking with motor vehicle level of service standards? They're antiquated, and I just kind of don't see them matching the pillars that we've identified and envisioned Eugene. So some clarification around that would be really awesome.
I would express the same concern, only from the opposite viewpoint. I don't consider them antiquated. They are.
Like we'll have a lively future meeting.
But I think that's a place where more definition discussion is definitely required.
Absolutely. I intended to have a kind of a strategy for this before this meeting, but haven't been able to close the loop with the public works staff. But I'll be in contact with Kurt Yeider, and we'll figure out a good time to bring this topic forward. Okay.
And I'm just going to keep my comments to transportation as well, not to the other areas. But the one thing that I think that we should mention somewhere is either in system-wide policies or specific policies is we need to complete the transit system so it hits all of the major service points. Right now, you still can't get to the airport except by a rather expensive taxi. That, you know, if someone was working there, that would take almost like half or three quarters of their salary just to pay for a taxi going back and forth to work each day. So, I'm a little concerned about the parking policy. I would feel more comfortable with talking about reducing neighborhood community parking. I would be more comfortable with a goal. I mean, given that our target is, despite, 2033, to double our transit front from these other modes, that still leaves the majority of transit being taken care of by cars. Mm-hmm. And so I would feel more comfortable if we had a policy to try to encourage single-car households rather than try to deal with the parking issue, because that would be more helpful in reducing the demand for parking, and yet it would still allow all the majority of trips that are still planned by 2033, which would be by car, have them a way to store that car when they get somewhere, like their home or whatever, or work or business or shopping. And also, I'm a little concerned about the passenger rail policies, because right now we're looking at a situation where Eugene may end up with one passenger rail train a day through Eugene. There's a strong likelihood that may be the case, that because the feds have dropped funding for passenger rail, and the state has to pick up the entire package. That we're lucky if we may have two trains a day, rather than just the one Amtrak one from Southern California to Washington. Mm-hmm. So I think that as much as pie in the sky, these things need to be, these goals, I think we ought to make sure that we have some grounding so mm-hmm. that, if our goal is really to maintain the current level of train service, if that's really what we're trying to get at for the next 5 or 10 years, that's maybe an important goal to put there. And then maybe a longer-term goal would be to increase that. But right now, it seems like the goal would be to try to maintain the current level of passenger rail service between Eugene and Portland. Mm-hmm. So,
Commissioner Mills, a couple, two or three more points on Chapter 8. On page 6, above policies, item 5, by year 2035, double percentage of trips made on foot by bike and by transportation. And I guess, I'm not asking what they are, but I think it would be good to have what those are. State what your goals are. Don't just say double. Say we want to go from this, where we were in 2014, to that. Under policies, second bullet, strive for zero transportation-related facilities.
Fatalities.
Fatalities, thank mm-hmm. you. New glasses are definitely required. Okay. And then the last one is facilitate safer conditions through speed limits, which generally would mean, I would assume to mean to lower them. And this is, I believe, probably has to take place with some kind of policy change at the state level, I think, because aren't we constrained by state policies for speed limits most of the time? I mean, there are a number of roads we hear talked about pretty consistently where a group of many people want those limits lowered, and we're told they can't be lowered.
Mm-hmm.
So just a question here, what kind of actions would you be taking? I presume that that'll be covered, so that'd be a question I would have about that.
Great, thank you. I'll pass all of those questions on.
I have a general question related to the comp plan and the metro plan and that transition. Is now a good time for that, or should I wait?
Nope, now's a good time.
I guess I'm just wondering, as we get into the adoption time and we're still refining and fleshing things out, and we have, you know, the kind of the pieces of the metro plan and pieces of the new plan, as planning action would go forward, let's say a developer wants to do something, how would we, I mean, how are we going to resolve potential conflicts? Because I'm sure at some point there's going to be a conflict between one or the other. Which one would control if there is a conflict? Have we kind of got that in place as far as how to navigate that?
Yeah, we're working through that, and Alyssa can correct me if I say anything that's not correct, but we're taking a very intentional and legal approach to being very clear about what policies are being amended with the adoption package and what policies will continue to apply. So our hope is that will be very clear and separate. New policies that guide city action under the Envision Eugene Comprehensive Plan, and policies that remain applicable under the existing structure of the Metro Plan.
Okay.
So, for instance, we'll note in the Metro Plan that the economic development policies no longer apply to Eugene, and then the Envision Eugene Comprehensive Plan will have all of our economic development policies. So there won't be any overlap.
Okay.
Hopefully that will reduce or eliminate any conflicts.
Okay.
Knock on wood. In the case of conflicts, I mean, we are working with MLA on some language to, I think in that case, we would hope that the Envision Eugene would be the controlling document.
I just anticipate that. I mean, there's so much there on both plans.
Yes.
That inevitably, I don't care how careful everybody is, I think inevitably there's going to be some conflict somewhere.
Right.
And it'll come out when somebody's applying for a zone change or a PUD, and to be able to have at least a path to take,
right.
I think would be wise.
It's going to be, you know, yeah, take some time to incrementally move all the policies from the Metro Plan and have new policies in the comp plan, our comp plan. So you're right. We will definitely make sure that there's language that speaks to any conflicts.
Okay. Thank you. Did you have also, John?
Yeah, okay. At some point.
Let's go Commissioner Brodsky, then Commissioner Baker.
Okay, so I'm getting into the chapters that we were supposed to study for today.
Oh, okay. We're not quite there yet.
Oh, okay.
Actually.
All right. Then I'll wait.
Oh, do we want
go
to?
Ahead. No, go ahead.
My question, my comment is this. I was going to hold off on it, but I agree with Commissioner Randall, but I think the issue is not a conflict between the comp plan and the metro plan, but in the case where we have conflicting policies in our own Envision Eugene documents, and we have conflicts that have to be worked out.
Internal conflicts.
For example, you know, you're trying to maintain and preserve, you know, affordable housing, and you're doing something else that may remove it. I mean, there's probably many different places where there are potential conflicts between the various goals and policies set out in the various chapters.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I was thinking of. At least should be mentioned that there are the potential for conflicts. You know, either you work out some process where the city council reviews the, in other words, you don't have to have a process, but at least admit that you're going to have those, and, you know, be prepared for cases where, I mean, there are conflicts between whatever, one of these three chapters or four or five chapters that we're considering now, there are some conflicts between these goals and policies, so we need to Now, that's different from conflicts with the metro plan.
No.
That's internal conflicts.
It's different.
Just because you have multiple goals and policies, and you, mm-hmm. you can't really usually meet them all, you know.
It's kind of a good topic for the intercommission workshop, where we're talking about all aspects of the plan and how we work to balance that when we're doing policymaking for the city. That may be a place where we can flesh that out a little bit.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
And then we'll wait on Commissioner Brodsky's.
Yeah, because as far as the table of contents, I think we're done with that. And the next piece really relates to your question, Commissioner Randall, is the goals and policies overview. So what this is an introduction to the comprehensive plan and an introduction to all the chapters, 1 through 9, how to read goal language, how to read policy language, and what those two things are intended to do for the city. So about halfway down the page, it describes what a goal is and then what a policy is, and basically the goals are broad statements that describe collective hopes for the future of the community. They're very aspirational. We've tried to make them structured as nouns. So this is getting into a little bit of the weeds, but it's important for the structure of the document to make sense, and that's what we've tried to do with the goal language, is to have a statement about what we want the future to be like. And then the policies are statements adopted as legal policies that move our community towards attainment of the goals. And they're a little bit more lengthy. They will be used, and this is an important distinction. The policies in the Envision Eugene Comprehensive Plan are envisioned to guide city actions and are not envisioned to be used as land use application criteria. And this distinction is important that we set out at the very beginning of the plan, so that as we go down the line, land use application criteria, you know, it's very clear to what the policies are intended to do. This is a huge source of interpretation in the current metro plan, and something that we've strived pretty hard in the drafting of the chapters to be clear about. So that's the main thing, the main message I wanted to put out to you for a discussion of goals and policies.
So I have a question on that then. So if, and this is just to help make me clear. So if it's not going to be used mm-hmm. as a criteria for a land use mm-hmm. thing, then what would be used for criteria is what's in the code? Mm-hmm. Is that what you're saying?
Mm-hmm.
And then if that's the case, where do refinement plans and area plans play into that as criteria?
Mm-hmm. If they're already adopted, they remain.
Okay. Because in the past, wasn't it metro? It was area plans, then to metro. And if there was a conflict, mm-hmm. the metro.
Metro plan controls. Right.
So this plan, if there's an area plan and this plan, mm-hmm. will this plan control or not?
That'll have to be worked out with the adoption of each plan. But our intent is to clarify that upon adoption of each of those implementing.
And so what I'm saying is, so we've got area plans and refinement plans that are right. 20, 25 years old.
Right.
Will those trump this comp plan then? Since you're writing it in as this is not a...
Right. I want to have that discussion with Emily in the room, because as it relates to land use decision making,
mm-hmm.
I want to have her perspective on that, so I'll invite her to a future conversation about that.
I mean, because for me, we've struggled with that before. We've looked at mm-hmm. we've looked at the Willa Kenzie plan, and we've looked at the Metro plan, and we had direction that if there was ambiguity, you'd go to this one.
Yep.
And it seems to me what we're losing by putting that statement in there is that we're losing an evolved metro, you know, an evolved higher,
mm-hmm.
you know, we look at the two plans and the metro plan. In some cases, the area plan is better because it's recent and it reflects what the community's values are.
Mm-hmm.
But if we're using one that's 25 years old, which most of them are, it may not be reflecting the most current mm-hmm. values and where the community wants to go. Whereas this is more in tune with what I feel, or I would hope, that the direction the community wants to go. But we're taking this away as being the trump card. And so I'm concerned about that.
Well, my perspective on that is not that we're taking away, but that we're being ultra clear about what our community values and policies are doing in terms of guiding our city actions and what we're doing to actually implement those hopes. This has played out, as you know, through the discussion about South Willamette. And so when you get down to that detailed level of implementation, that's when you make that judgment call. Are we implementing our broad hopes expressed in that case in the South Willamette concept plan? Or are we not? And upon adoption of those implementing tools like special area zones and zoning and things like that is when I would hope that that would be really clear is what the city is doing. Does that make sense?
It does, and that I can buy in on that mm-hmm. on updated plans and studies, mm-hmm. but I can.
The question is about existing adopted refinement plans. Yeah, we'll come back on that one.
And maybe there's something that says, you know, if it's over 20 years old, I don't know how to get around it, but that's a concern that I have.
Yeah. Commissioner Jaworski, then Commissioner Baker.
I just wanted to follow up on what Commissioner Borowski was saying. This is pretty specific in saying that it's only the code that influences land use decisions. And as again, as Commissioner Borowski brought up, at the refinement level, it's not code. Mm-hmm. It's policy. So I think that somewhere in here there should be something said that clears that in the city's perspective it's using code, but it's not saying, well, your refinement plan doesn't have code, forget it. I think that there should be something that clarifies what it is.
That's a good point. And there is a section that is not complete yet that will be brought to you for review, which is the section of the comprehensive plan that talks about relationships to other plans. So it is on this point that we're all talking about.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, not ready yet.
Commissioner Baker.
Yeah. Well, actually, Commissioner Borowski and Commissioner Jaworski have both spoken to the issue that I have some concerns about. I'm concerned that we're developing a very generalized comprehensive plan, and when we do have new studies, for example, the new area plans that are being proposed for certain parts of the city now and are expected maybe next year, mm-hmm. that they're not relegated to be overwritten by the comprehensive plan that was completed this year.
Yeah.
Because the whole point is those are specific studies that are focusing on a specific area, and we're trying to get more detailed and maybe specific policies, you know, that relate to certain streets or parks or whatever. And so it is a challenge because you're trying to deal with ones that are going to be written after the comprehensive plan mm-hmm. and ones that were written before.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's not. Mm-hmm. And until these old ones are updated, which may not happen, but it would happen, say, around the university district, there's some way forward. But in some areas, the likelihood of getting some of these plans updated is pretty unlikely, and we don't want to wash away all the detailed work that was done in, say, the West Side, for example, and mm-hmm. all those changes that were only, 5 years old. I mean, they're not 25 years old.
Right. I want to be very clear, we're not proposing to dump any refinement plans. That is not even within the realm of possibility. What we just need to do is come back with a very clear way of understanding how to implement plans, just like you just said, plans that are already on the books and plans that will be coming out of Envision Eugene.
And I guess I'll jump in. I think I understand that, you know, the older refinement plans are policy in general and mm-hmm. and that and have a lot of shoulds and, mm-hmm. and that in them, whereas, you know, something like the South Willamette mm-hmm. plan is very specific down to parcel specific zoning and those sorts of things. And I think that's where the concern is mm-hmm. how you adjust that with some of those older refinement plans right. and the new comprehensive plan.
Right.
So, Commissioner Borowski.
And then the second question that I would have is the map. So is the comp plan going to have a parcel specific map?
Mm-hmm.
And if so, what is the policy or procedure for figuring out, because I mean we've looked at the 11 by 7 blob map, and you know, I mean, who's going to make that call that this parcel is R1 and this parcel is low medium density?
So it won't be part of this phase of the comprehensive plan, but we will be, as a future phase, bringing forward a parcel-specific diagram. So we'll take the diagram. So right now it's going to continue to live in the metro plan. Our intent will be to migrate that into the Envision Eugene comprehensive plan and make it parcel-specific. That work has actually been underway. It's just, as you might it's time-consuming, a little bit laborious to go through each and every parcel within our urban growth boundaries. So what is happening, I mean, there's a lot of areas where it's really easy, where there's a sea of low-density residential. And certainly there are a number of areas that we're having to look at very closely that will be brought back to you, that will be brought out to the public. So that will have its own process for folks to weigh in on.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that that... I mean, I think that's important because I think that's one of the things that we struggle with here a lot, especially in reviews and appeals. But then on the other hand, I mean, you're going to be having to notice
a lot of people.
A lot of people on that. So, okay.
Yeah, that will be next phase.
All right. Next phase or the third phase? Because there is already a next phase.
Right. Well, I don't know where that falls in on that.
I mean, we've been bringing chunks to you as they're ready, so we don't have the adoption process for the ultimate phases all mapped out yet. So I don't know if it would be part of the same package or not.
Thank you.
This is like a preview of your work plan for the next couple of years.
I think so.
Okay, should we jump into chapters 1 and 3?
Yes.
Okay, so chapter 1 is public involvement. That's actually really gratifying to have a draft, simple, I hope, elegant, chapter that guides the city's outreach for planning activities. So we've come up with 3 goals, and they're meaningful and equitable public participation, accessible and transparent processes, and integration of community values with technical analysis, and then a pretty short list of policies that go along with those goals. So I look forward to your comments.
Mr. George?
Was it just a typo to leave out sound technical analysis?
We got some feedback from the subcommittee that was a little clunky, so...
It's in ours. It said sound. Yeah.
Okay. Well, so what's your feeling about that?
Well, I just want to know if it was in or out. I don't have a particular feeling.
I'm hoping it would be redundant.
That was sort of my feeling. I felt like we didn't need to say it, but...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. For what it's worth, I would leave it out.
Okay.
I would hope our technical analysis would be sound, just as a given. Okay. Oh, Commissioner Baker.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention, because we've had complaints from public in the past on previous, the availability of copies. We used to have a policy where you made them available at the library and at the desk. And I think that might be a way of handling some of the criticism if there were copies that were in the reference section in the library.
Copies of what?
Paper copies?
Paper copies.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there have been complaints in the past about the lack of paper copies. That some of these documents are large. Not all of them sometimes are accessible or easily accessed off the web.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes broken links or whatever, and there's only, a week to look at it. And some people prefer to read, I'd say probably a certain number of the older generation prefer to read things in paper copy rather than online. So we need to make certain that we somehow cover that in our, you talk about it, but I just want to make sure that we consider that, and if the public would prefer to have it in two places, the library, which has much longer hours, because the problem with the planning department, it's only open during the week when a lot of people work,
whereas the library is open on evenings, certain evenings a week, and also all on weekends. So it makes the documents accessible where they're not necessarily accessible unless you have time off or you're retired from here.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Thanks. Others? I have to say this was probably the best chapter to start with because it's foundational, but it's not too tricky, I don't think, to have good, solid goals that inform the rest of the plan.
The trick is the execution and
absolutely.
The facilities that you develop to actually make these things happen and
yeah.
improve them.
We're going to be reliant on support from staff in the Equity and Human Rights Office. They have a diversity and equity strategic plan that guides public outreach and process for the city, and my hope is that that'll be more integrated with planning work as we go forward.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's move on to chapter three. Oops. We're making good time, so this is good. Chapter three is about economic development. This has been to the commission previously. You saw the policies in December. And this is an example of a chapter where under a lot of guidance and prescriptive expectations from the state statutes. So there's a lot of Oregon administrative rules that relate to planning for land supply and different types of land for jobs. So this is a pretty lengthy chapter, and it's mostly because of that content in the state documents. So our goals for economic development are household prosperity, business development, and community vitality. Throughout the comp plan, we thought it made sense to not expressly group the policies underneath the goals, but to allow them to live kind of separately. Because there's a lot of crossover. So it does go into some detail. There's subheadings for the policies, and they're grouped under overall economic development objectives, our targeted industries, which is familiar for those of you who've been working on the Clear Lake Road expansion area, a land supply section, short-term supply, infrastructure, and downtown. So there are quite a few policies. This is one of the longer chapters that you'll be reviewing, but the good news is you've had one opportunity to see them before, and I think they're in pretty good shape, but I look forward to your comments on these.
Mr. Baker?
The first thing is just the wording suggestion.
Mm-hmm.
In the second paragraph on page 18, I would take out Great Recession and just put it in lowercase and say
sure.
From the recent recession in whenever it was, 2008, 2012. I think you'll confuse some readers when you say Great Recession because I don't think that it was considered at the same level as the one in 1929. One other area that I had a question on is we've talked a lot about preserving these large lot preservation, and I'm wondering why this isn't applying to other areas other than Clear Lake. In other words, considering making some modifications to the codes in the area on some. There are some other lots that aren't in Clear Lake that are 10 acres or larger, and it seems to me if we have a shortage of large lots, and also I consider that it may be difficult and contentious to try to, depending on the adoption package, I'm a little skeptical that there may be some court issues and court challenges to preserving those lots if someone has a developer that only wants 5 acres and they're willing to pay the right price. I think there'll be contention. So I'm a little concerned that we maybe should also consider expanding that to the exist other lots that are above 10 acres because that seems to be your threshold for important size for some of these development sites.
Yeah, it's this is an area where there are state rules legal requirements for the expansion and to make sure that the land we're expanding for based on this analysis continues to meet our needs. So that's a very specific need that we have. And as it relates to the rest of the city, I know we've discussed this and Emily has an opinion about this, but I've marked it for a future question and answer because I know it has come up, but it's escaping me what the solution is right now. And I don't think anyone who's here has more information about that.
Well, I just want to add it doesn't have to be handled exactly the same way. In other words, when you bring in this other area and bring it in under code language, you might have a certain approach that you've used here to try to preserve those large lot sites. But in the other parts of Eugene, maybe there are some other mechanisms or incentives you can use to try to preserve. In other words, they don't have to be identical mechanisms.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But if the goal is to preserve large lots for future development, then it seems strange not to preserve the existing ones we already have, because they may be closer in to town and more attractive given their location. They're not out at the edge.
Yeah.
Or, you know, so that's all I was saying.
Great.
Mr. Mills.
Yeah, I've probably got 4 points, and I'll try to go quickly. One of them is, I'm going to call it my old saw under targeted industries, where I think there's been some cleanup versus what I've seen before. But, for example, I think there's some implied. Let me just say, for example, under bullet 3.10, clean technology and renewable energy, as if those are going to be the same if you're living next door to one versus the other. They won't be. Renewable isn't necessarily clean to live next door to. So I'm a little unclear once again what clean tech means. It would be good to have examples of what we have in mind. Another one is advanced manufacturing, where we talk about heavy machinery, advanced materials. Once again, that could come in conflict with what some people would call clean tech. As you know, I'm in support of broadening these categories as much as possible, because I think that we don't want to restrict ourselves. But I would still say there's some conflicts laden within that section. Going on to item 3.20, parcel assembly. Facilitate assembly of existing small industrial parcels to create redevelopment opportunities. And I'm just, you know, to me it's wonderful to say that as a goal, of course, but actually coming up with a methodology that you're going to do that, I'm going to be extremely interested in see how that's going to work. So that'd be my question and comment about that. Item 3.23, advanced environmental justice and compatibility. It says under sub-item A, in areas that already accommodate a disproportionate amount of such uses, or B, near residentially designated lands, schools, daycare centers, and so on, that land use codes is revised to avoid the siting of new heavy industries in these areas. And I'm curious how that's going to work. I mean, I think I understand where it's at, but that's another challenge. Are you going to say that here's an area that's coded E1 or E2, but because there's already something there next door and there's houses, you know, 1,000 feet away, you can't put it there even though it's zoned for that? I mean, how is that going to work?
It's intended to be guidance to the work that we're implementing right now with the Clear Lake area. So if you think of it as, again, guidance to the city in doing land use planning, deciding where to expand and how to arrange land uses in our expansion areas, this is what we heard from the community about how to arrange that area, and we've tried to reflect that in a general policy.
And once again, I'm not contesting the goal. I think the devil is in the details. How are you actually going to make that happen? What will it look like?
Sure.
What will the language look like? Two more items, and I'll be quick. Okay. Item 3.24, short-term supply, provide a competitive short-term supply of land for the industrial land or employment uses identified. And I'm not quite sure what that short-term supply represents. Is that the existing supply versus what we're going to move the boundary to get additional,
It has a specific definition in state OAR, which I can't quote off the top of my head, but it's a certain number of percentage of your overall supply has to be shovel-ready within 5 years. That's short-term supply.
Okay,
And we're required to prove that we have that upon adoption of the urban growth boundary.
I keep trying to interrupt you, Terry.
It's okay.
I apologize. That takes us to item 335, which is site preparedness. In particular, the last sentence of item 335, in particular, explore a private-public partnership to address, as you know better than anybody,
yes.
wetlands permitting issues on larger industrial sites. I mean, this is going to get right into the weeds for 324 in terms of a lot of this new land supply actually being anywhere near shovel-ready without getting some kind of wetlands bank or something like that up and running.
We're not anticipating that the expansion area is part of our short-term supply. We're not counting on that for the five-year short-term supply.
So then,
however, we're going to jump right into this.
I was just going to say, let's set that aside. And then my other questions are, what steps are underway? What are the next steps? And, of course, once again, this is a significant, important goal.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm very curious to see what we're actually able to write down about what we're doing and how we're doing. Thank you.
Just so the whole commission and everybody watching knows that the next steps for preparing land for development in the Clear Lake area are, number one, establish the urban growth boundary. So the city has jurisdiction over the land to do that coordination work with the state agencies and the landowners and the community. After that, we have some infrastructure and master planning type work to do, and then we move into the more specific economic development work, such as enterprise zone conversations, programs to help targeted industries, and those kinds of things.
Thank you.
Commissioner Borowski.
Yeah. So for me, a couple of the things that stood out and that I would like to see addressed in here is, when it comes to economic development, for me, one of the leading things as far as economic development is growing existing businesses, okay? And so for me, there were a couple of areas that I took a little bit of issue with, and part of it goes to, I went to the briefing that the council had on economic development a week and a half, 2 weeks ago. But if we look in the introduction, there's a sentence in the first paragraph that says, the city has become more integrated into the global marketplace and grown away from primary natural resource-based economy to a more diverse-based economy of industry, commerce, and entrepreneurship. I might want to put that the city is becoming more integrated into the global marketplace and is growing away from, because it hasn't grown away from wood, from natural resource, and I don't think we necessarily have to or want to. I mean, I'll put it right out there. The wood products industry has always been a large part of our economy, and I think will always continue to be. If you looked at the slides that were put up during that presentation on economic development, the number of jobs that are paying the types of wages that we want to get paid, wood products and wood product derivative areas are a large majority of those. And so, yes, we can move into these other areas, but let's not throw out the baby with the bathwater. You know, I think that there is areas of for us to move forward using the resources that we have here. You know, and some of those resources are wood products, but there's other resources that we have here that may be coming, emerging. You know, water is a resource that we have here that may become a very valuable resource, you know, that even for coolings and other things, not necessarily consumption of water or using it as irrigation stuff. I think water, and so for me to when you move on to that, into the targeted industries, I think there might be an area to put in there, you know, enhance and bring the, you know, the industries that we have here to newer levels, mm-hmm. you know. And that can meet some of the other needs. I mean, you talk about sustainability. Well, a good way to sequester carbon is to cut the tree and put it into a house that's going to stand for 50 years, as opposed to letting that tree burn or you know, you're sequestering that carbon in lumber for 50 years if it's in a house or longer. And there's other areas that wood products and other things can be used, and maybe, you know, instead of concrete power poles, you use glue lamp power poles. Mm-hmm. That's sequestering things. So I just see some of the industries that we have here, that we can grow here, that we can advance here, maybe need to end up into some of the targeted industries. And there's just a small little bullet point of advanced wood products there.
Secondary is
secondary.
The language used there. And I agree with you, and thanks for bringing that up. Wood products has been a part of the discussion. The Regional Prosperity Plan emphasizes it, so we'll see if we can reflect that.
Commissioner Jaworski.
Yeah, just to elaborate on what some of the commissioners indicated before. Commissioner Mills under 3.23, where he talked about item B, it might be nice to define what near means. You know, either be specific, since this will, or maybe it is in code. I have no idea, but I can't remember. But near is pretty general.
Yeah. The way that one works, it does get very specific in the Clear Lake Overlay Zone, which implements this policy. So, yeah, it's that balance of having the right level of policy guidance in a policy like this one, and then hard specifics in the implementing tools.
Because, see, someone might interpret near to mean, you know, abutting, adjacent, or mm-hmm. within 10,000 yards. Who knows?
Right.
Okay. To follow up on Commissioner Borowski, existing, or I had mentioned prior, you know, the retention issue?
Right, yes.
Okay. It might be interesting or something to consider under your 3.2, where you talk about strengths or advantages, maybe to give the little small guy a break, you might want to say an added one might be a diversified business base, the existing business base, mm-hmm. as an asset. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. One would have to really totally analyze it, but it would be nice to indicate that we're starting from nowhere. We do have a good asset in our existing business base.
Absolutely.
Just a comment.
Thank you. Okay. Good. You guys are doing great. You're excited to talk about bike parking, right? Okay.
Not that we're not excited about this, too.
No, it's policy stuff. It's a little on the dry side, but I appreciate everything. The subcommittee has been a subcommittee of two with the departure of Commissioner Duncan, so when you have an opportunity to talk about subcommittees on, I think, August 10th, next week. We'll be looking to round out the comprehensive plan subcommittee.
We've had three.
Well, Bree's been attending our meetings because she's a new commissioner and was being brought up to speed on the whole process, but she's not formally on.
Oh, so we don't have to listen to it.
Yep, you can just ignore everything I say. Just a paper bag over my head.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks, Gary.
Thank you.
Steven, did you have something?
Oh, I'm sorry, did you have your hand?
I just had one other thing flagged here. I just figured I'd mention it. Although it's actually in Chapter 2. We're not covering Chapter 2, are we?
We'll be back with Chapter 2 in September.
Yeah. It's just
a pretty meaty one.
I just had a...
I can't hear him.
I just had two areas that I'd flagged in the general TOC. One was under Chapter 1, Design for Equity, and just, you know, need to flush that out a little bit more, exactly what we mean by that.
We reviewed that policy today as part of the Chapter 1 draft in your packet.
Yeah, but I still have some concern about the balance. In other words, there's certain areas where there may be existing lower cost housing, and that may be proposed for upzoning and redevelopment, which would remove it So I think that there, you know, we still have to do some balancing.
That policy in particular is talking about designing the public involvement process for equity.
Right.
But yes, Chapter 2 gets into more issues about compact development and different land use arrangements.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And my other thing was neighborhood vitality, which we haven't discussed related to the chapters we've looked at today.
Okay, got it.
Thank you, Terry.
Sure. Let's see if I can escape here.
So next on our agenda is bike parking and Reed Dunbar.
Reed, did you put your presentation on the desktop here?
Up there.
Oh, there it is.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
I'm going to use that. So if you can't, can everybody turn and kind of see that?
Yeah.
I even have a little laser and I might point at things.
Should we turn
my laser turns back on?
Yeah,
we
lights down, maybe?
Yeah.
You probably don't need this.
No, I'm going to discard that.
There you go.
Good.
Okay, so I included in the AIS a brief discussion of why we're talking about bike parking. And first of all, my name is Reed Dunbar. I work in transportation planning, which is in public works engineering. And I work primarily on projects for walking and biking and to improve the comfort, viability, security of people, for people who walk and bike. Obviously, a consideration in biking is end-of-trip accommodation. So we do hear from people, continue to hear from people who say, I would bike more, except when I go to work, I can't put my bike somewhere. Or I do not feel good about going to the store because when I have to park my bike, I don't know if it's going to be there, that sort of thing. And so that level of anxiety is something that we can tackle through code to make sure that there is better facilities for people when they arrive at their destination. And there's a lot of guidance on that. So this isn't something that we're making up. I want to talk today specifically about the basics of bike parking so that when we come back with some possible code improvements, you know why we're recommending what we're recommending. And then I'm going to talk about some additional considerations. There have been some improvements and advances in the types of bikes that people use and the type of bike parking elements that are available for people. And I'd like to talk a little bit about that so that perhaps we can talk about that as part of this process as well. So, basics of bike parking. This is kind of the go-to document for bike parking best management practices. It's through APBP, which is the Association of Pedestrian and Bicycle Professionals, of which I'm a member. They also do a really nice webinar series, and we could certainly add you to our list if you don't get those invites now, talking about all things related to walking and biking. This document was prepared originally in 2002. It was updated in 2013. It is a compendium of best practices from around the nation. It uses input from people who develop code, from manufacturers, from basically people in the bike industry to identify what the best practices for bike parking is. So we do look at this when we start to look at what our existing standards are to see if they are part of the best management protocol, and by and large they are, but there are some emerging technologies and standards that we need to be aware of. I want to talk a little bit about location. Location is kind of the ball game here, because if bike parking is inconvenient, if it is not accessible to the front door in a way that is clear and concise, people do not think that bike parking exists at that location. So we need to be very careful about where we select to put and place bike parking and ensure that it is developed as part of the overall site plan. We also need to recognize that bike parking needs to fit within the existing context of the place. So especially in downtown areas where we put a bike parking rack somewhere on the sidewalk, we need access around that rack to that rack. And in that area, especially for people, say, who are in cars and need to open doors, or for people with a mobility assistance device who need to travel around that facility. The rack type should support the bicycle in at least two locations, and what that really does is it limits the amount of rack types that are best practice, and I'll talk about those a little bit. We also want to ensure that people can use U-locks, because most of the bikes that are stolen in Eugene are either not locked up at all or they use a cable lock. If you look at the labels on cable locks now, all of them that I've seen say accessory lock, which means your bicycle wheels are an accessory that you lock to the frame, but you lock the frame with a U-lock. So U-locks are those metal U-bolt locks that aren't very long, and so the rack really needs to be able to conform to the shape of the bicycle. The rack itself needs to be securely anchored to the ground. If you can pick up the rack and take off with it and the bike, that isn't very helpful. The rack element itself needs to be very durable material. For people who have been in places like Sisters, there's a lot of wood bike racks around that community. I don't think they're necessarily for security, but for convenience. Those are things that we do look at. And then works with a wide variety of frame types, and I talked about that a little bit. And so when you add all of that together, oh, go ahead.
Do you want us to hold questions till the end or to interject as you go along?
Doesn't matter to me.
Okay.
Well, my particular question was back about the previous drawing. Or previous discussion. Keep going. That one. The one thing that I missed there is there's a problem with racks that are too, the tube is too large, because then the U-bolt won't go around it, and I didn't notice it here.
Okay.
And I think it should be make sure you include that, the diameter or the cross-section of the thing, that because sure. That is a problem for a lot of people, that, you know, you have a U-bolt and it won't fit around this giant 2.5 or 3 inch tube. So it doesn't function with a U-bolt.
Right. And so that pertains to some of the fancier racks, like outside of whatever the fancy glass building is on campus? With big O's? Like, you can't get a U-lock around those.
The Jaquil Center.
Jaquil Center.
Yeah, and there, you know, there's the sandwich shop at 25th and Willamette that it's approaching that diameter as well. I mean, there are other places where you have this problem. It's not just...
Correct.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. I'm a little bit hidden. Another question, too, is will your features also include the distance between the bike rack itself and walls? For example, I'm thinking, or other like features, I'm thinking of downtown, for example, where you have some bike racks that are situated to brick planters, I believe they are, and you have to actually put your bike sideways, basically up against the rack to get it to fit. So thinking about kind of just like the distance between those features, is that going to be a requirement that you're looking at?
Yep, okay. And it currently is.
Oh, good.
So we do have...
Those are intended as bike rack.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
One question I had, I'll just jump in too, is...
There's a microphone.
Touché. You said logical path to the front door. I'm assuming that's a logical path as you're approaching on a bike, not necessarily from like a parking lot. I know some businesses I've been to, as you approach from the bike, it's, you know, the parking's behind the building,
right?
As is the bike parking, and that isn't, it's not as intuitive.
Yeah, and we'll talk a little bit about the differences between long-term and short-term and who we expect to get into that building.
Okay.
But like the best management practice in APBP is, you know, as close, and I think our code is as close as the nearest automobile parking space. And then the best management practice, I think, is like within 50 feet of the front door. And so you really want to make it clear, like, where the front door is, and most architects have that nailed. They put nice things around the front door, and, you know, bike parking needs to be somewhere within that view shed so people can figure it out, generally speaking. This is what I mean by two points of contact. When you set a bicycle against a rack element, if there's only one point of contact, the front wheel can flip around and the bike falls down. A lot of the more wavy style racks that you see, especially on campus, there's a lot of them downtown as well, only have one point of contact. And so those place a lot of pressure against the frame. People worry about scratching their bikes for good reason, because they tend to fall down in that location. Different types of bikes work really well with this type of design. I've also got arrows pointed to say, you know, it needs to be securely anchored to the ground, which we'll talk a little bit about. And then you can see the U-lock is there, is placed through a front wheel and the frame itself. So that's generally an image that captures everything we're trying to accomplish with bike parking in terms of what the element looks like.
Yeah, I just wanted to throw in a comment. One of the issues is a lot of bicycles don't have kickstands.
Right.
I mean, you know, to save on weight or cost or whatever. And so there isn't any way to balance the bicycle unless you lean it up against something, and you can't, like you say, those wavy ones and other places like that. So
this works better.
This works better. Yeah, yeah. You need the two points of contact, because that's just a style of bicycles that we that seem to be predominant nowadays, or without kickstands.
Yep.
I just had a quick. Why would you show on the front wheel rather than the U-lock on the rear wheel with has all the gears and everything? That's probably the wheel someone would want to take.
Mm-hmm. And honestly, if this was like a best, if this showed how we would want people to lock up a bike, we'd also have a cable through that U-lock, and then it would go through the rear wheel.
Okay.
So either a U-lock through the front or the rear, and then depending on where you are and how long you're going to be there, a cable around a wheel is also a good idea. Or there's aftermarket wheel locks, which I use on my bike, that require a proprietary wrench to get the wheels off, and so there's some stuff like that out there too. So that rack also works with big bikes. And when I talk about a standard bike, it's the standard one person rides a bike. It's about 6 feet long. It's about 2 feet wide at the handlebars, that sort of thing. There's a lot of different styles of bikes that have been coming out, and we've been adopting different styles from other places based on what our needs are. Sometimes we're moving cargo. Sometimes we're moving family members. Sometimes both. And so the inverted style rack, like an inverted U, really works well to accommodate that. But we also need to be aware of, you know, just the space required to accommodate those types of bikes is a little bit bigger than our standard space. And so one of the things we will be talking about in future sessions is what does the space look like for a standard bike? And I think we've nailed it. It's about 6x2. And what does the space look like for a non-standard bike? And it's going to be a little bit bigger than that. And maybe there's a percentage that we could require that looks at these types of bikes for certain destinations like elementary schools or grocery stores or those types of things.
Could you help me with that? I learned a new term, and it's the, is it Bockfiets?
Bockfiets. So that was an example of a Bockfiets, which means box bike. So the box is kind of in front there, and then there's the bike that's attached to it. Also, in terms of BMPs, bicycle materials and hardware, the durability of the materials is really important. Most of the steel racks that are in our community are either powder coated or they have like a vinyl coating, and that really ensures that the rack itself is very durable and lasts a long time. The rectangular shape is kind of an emerging standard that we need to be aware of, and as we talk about diameters, as you mentioned, in different tube standards, we should also accommodate for round and square tubing so that we don't get a situation where with a standard pipe cutter, which is an $8 tool at any Home Depot, you can cut right through a round tube, but the square tube, you can't do that. So we can look at things like that that increase the amount of security for these rack elements. But no rack element is completely resistant, and given enough time, your bike can disappear. So we understand that, but there are things we can do to mitigate that. One of those is ensuring that we mount the rack correctly, and not only in terms of spacing from walls and other street furniture, but also the way that the rack is mounted to the surface. Tamper-resistant fasteners is a really easy way to accommodate that. If you look around downtown, you won't see any of those. We use a standard bolt. If you have a wrench, you can probably remove the rack itself. Which is why I prefer like mounting the racks themselves to rails. There's a couple reasons I prefer that alternative. One is you mount the inverted part directly to a rail. So this is usually welded on. And then when you mount this whole series of racks to the ground, you need fewer bolts and attachment points, because basically you're just trying to keep this from moving around. You're not trying to keep the security of the rack from lifting off the ground. The other way to do it would be to put the rack element itself directly into the concrete in front of the Lane Community College here across from the library. It's a good example. Those are all embedded directly into the concrete and offer a lot of security. currently our code is silent on that, by the way. So spacing is also important, and we touched on that. Bree mentioned it. Like, these racks are far too close together. So there is some best management practices I mentioned. This is a figure directly out of our current code. It's very good. Talks about what a space is in terms of not a rack, but a space. So on a standard rack, you can usually get two spaces, so you can lock on each side of that rack. The space itself is 6 feet long, and that's because a bike is generally about 6 feet long, and then 2 feet wide, because that's about how wide handlebars are, and if they're not, you can generally turn them, or you can get them past the bike next to you, and that sort of thing. So spacing is really good. I think one of the things to look at here, too, is this access aisle, which the previous slide did not show, is like, what's the plan here? So there's not appropriate spacing there to actually park bikes as intended. So the elements of spacing include kind of your the length of the bicycle, the width of the bicycle, and then how you plan on getting the bicycle in and out of that space. And again, I think our current standards are very good in that regard. And I wanted to touch on long-term and short-term, and then I'll talk about some of the emerging standards. So our current code talks about both of these, which is great. Generally speaking, short-term is I'm going to the grocery store, or I'm going to a restaurant, or I'm going somewhere where I plan on leaving the bike outside for, you know, somewhere over 2 hours, or just short of around 2 hours is generally the guidance. Long-term bike parking is I'm working at this destination, and so I'm going to be there all day. I live at this destination, so I need a long-term secure space for my bike. Or I'm at transit, I'm trying to use transit and trip change, so I can go park my bike at a transit station, use transit to get to where I need to, and then come back to my bike later, and it is secure, and I know that it's going to be there. Generally speaking, short-term is a simple inverted U-rack. It's generally unsheltered, although we do have some guidance for how many shelters we would like, especially in our environment where it gets rainy. People prefer to have a sheltered bike rack. And typically, as I mentioned, you know, commercial, retail, medical, healthcare, something where you're coming in for an appointment, you're coming in to shop, maybe you're getting a beer or something like that. That's more of a short-term destination. Long-term destinations are going to be where we work, where we live, or if there are any places along the way where we're going to leave our bike for a long period of time. So with that, here's some additional considerations and some of the emerging stuff we need to start to consider. This, by the way, is an on-street bike corral. There are a couple of those in our community now. I think we have four. This was our latest one. This is on 12th Avenue in front of a yoga studio. So long-term bike parking rooms. Now, currently we require developers to build these as part of their structural development. They generally take the form of a large room. This one is concrete and also has glass on the outside, which is really nice, so that you can see inside of that room before you open the door and walk inside. For people who are concerned about security, it's really nice to have that visual inspection before you enter the room. Also, when you're walking by, you can casually kind of see what's going on in there. Really adds to the use of that facility.
What size of a development would trigger that?
So those are the ones over in the Walnut District. That is, I think, the loft.
Skybox.
I think that was Skybox.
So, I mean, that what I'm asking is, what is the trigger? So if I build a restaurant, do I have to build an extra room for that? Or
generally speaking, there is some quantity of long-term and short-term that's required.
Right, I know that, and I've got that. But, I mean, so those are in the codes as far as square footage that you have to, and is that based on employees? Is that based on square footage of the facility? Can you enlighten me on this?
I think it's based on,
it's typically based on square footage.
There's a whole chart in the code based on use and whether it's restaurant or office or whatever, and how much is short-term and how much is long-term.
Right.
Yeah, so correct. If we're building a new restaurant, you would need to provide one bicycle parking space for each 600 square feet, but you always had to provide four. So if that worked out to three spaces, you would still have to provide four spaces, 25 of which would need to be long-term, 75% would need to be short-term. So you'd need to provide, if that new restaurant, one space inside, so you wouldn't be looking at a room that big.
And I guess one of my questions is, if it's based on square footage, I'm not sure that is necessarily the best metrics to use, because what if you had a Hyundai that's turned into a server farm, and you've got 100,000 square feet of space and 14 employees, and you're required to have 100 long-term parking spots because of the square footage or whatever. So, I mean, I think that let's look at the different uses as opposed to, you know, I've got a restaurant and I've got 4,000 square feet, but I may have 18 employees working at that time. So just to correlate it with square footage, I don't know if that's going to be your best.
Well, to clarify, I only gave you what the square footage requirement is for restaurants.
So sure,
there's a whole range of square footage requirements depending on the use. So we tried to think for those larger, you know, buildings that actually didn't have as many employees. Mm-hmm. Square footage ratio is definitely different.
Right.
Nothing would preclude a property owner from providing more bicycle parking than required.
Mm-hmm.
And then if there was a case where, it, you know, for whatever reason, the numbers, it just seemed wrong, mm-hmm. I believe right now somebody could request an adjustment review and ask, you know, that we think this is the appropriate. I think we had actually one before we did some changes.
The arena, I think the arena did the arena get an adjustment review for bicycle parking?
I don't know the answer.
I think that was one of the other ones where it was just like, mm-hmm. you know, it was just massive amounts of bicycle parking, and they did provide a lot, but I mean it was like probably more than ever use it, but I don't know. So
there are a few uses we've noted, specifically yoga studios, which don't get their own category in the table, unfortunately. They are always underserved. There's never enough parking in those. Or, you know, lately it's been a lot of the local craft breweries don't tend to have enough bike parking either. So we can look at those types of adjustments. I think those are some of the only ones I can think of where we would want to add more.
Well, and then for me, again, I don't know if it's necessarily to regulate it too much. I mean, as a business owner, and as, you know, so if I'm a yoga studio and I know that a large percentage of my clientele bike to work, one of the things that I'm going to do to attract clientele is add more parking, bicycle parking. You know, I don't necessarily, I mean, a certain percentage of it, yeah, but I, you know, part of it is I'm putting a thing out there mm-hmm. to bring customers in, using it as an amenity, mm-hmm. as, you know, the carrot or the stick.
So what we're providing is a basic minimum for what we think you will attract reasonably. We're not saying this is the full array. The best example recently, I think, is Whole Foods, where we did have a discussion with them, and we're like, well, I think we know your clientele for this community as well, because the grocery stores are another one where we generally don't have enough bike parking. And they agreed, yeah, let's do a little bit more than that. But they were not required, really, to put in enough. So we can negotiate stuff like that. We're just trying to get in a basic number, a rack or two, for a lot of uses is basically what it means.
Okay.
And so then, again, some of this is to relieve anxiety. Some of this is to ensure that when you arrive at that destination, there is something for you, so you felt like that trip was worth taking and taking by bike. So that's, it's part of the encouragement programming that we're looking at as an overall transportation product for the city.
Just as a note about language, I would like to caution against referring to bike parking as an amenity. I think that I generally, because I see it as a mode equivalent to any other, I mean, I wouldn't refer to car parking as an amenity. I would refer to it as a requirement. So just to kind of note that language, I think that is important to see it as an absolute requirement, especially as more and more people start to use it. Just so kind of as a note about that there.
But I see car parking as an amenity as well.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
One of my restaurants has parking as an amenity, and the other one doesn't, you know, and I wish it had. I wish one of mine had more parking.
I get a bit nervous when people refer to it as an amenity, because there's a lot of places who, if it wasn't required, it absolutely would not be there. So that's kind of just where my caution about that arose from. But thank you for clarifying.
Yeah, I had a conversation with a local architect about a concern that they had, because they were redeveloping a spot in the strip mall, and the requirement was that they had to upgrade all of the bicycle parking for the whole mall. So I think we need to make certain in our language the scope of what, in other words, if you are working within a larger context of a development, and all, you know, it's an existing mall, and it's, you're going in and you know, changing a use or whatever, that, you know, you meet the parking requirements for that specific. And their concern was the indoor parking, because the way they describe it is, in an existing space like that, it's just as costly to provide indoor parking as it is to provide, you know, completely conditioned space, because that's what it's coming out of. So it's more for the long-term parking that there's a concern. So anyway, there should be some language to clarify that when you are doing a, I don't know what, there's probably a name for what you call a development within a larger development.
Tenant infill,
that the parking requirements would be tied to that tenant infill, not to the entire project, development site.
Okay, we can talk about that. This keeps coming up, so I want to mention it. I'm going to get to it in my slides too. Is part of what I want to talk about is different types of rack elements that utilize space much more efficiently. Currently, what we hear from the development community is that I'm required to provide this indoor space, and either nobody's using it, or it's taking away from too much leasable space that would make the project otherwise, you know, more viable for me and that sort of. So we're looking at ways to provide a level of service for people who bike that also that would make that development more attractive to a greater range of people, but also recognizes that we're not using space efficiently necessarily in the way that the current code is written. And I'll get into the different types of racks we could use to improve that. One of the other things that we've noticed around town, and this is 13th and Olive, and this is the alley through Capstone. So this is an approved product. They put this steel structure over this long-term bike parking cage after the original chain link that was there was easily defeated. And we've noticed that chain link as a material for long-term bike parking is really easy to defeat. We've had, even in our building in Public Works, we've had bikes and trailers stolen out of that facility. We need a more durable product, and really that's an emerging standard. I was in Seattle a couple weeks ago and got off the train and noticed that they were building a long-term bike parking structure there, and they use like a wire mesh, which is just a better product. You can't defeat it just using like a clippers or anything. You can't get in there and then use the door to get out. You would have to remove the entire panel. So this is a discussion I think we're going to need to have, because when we say long-term secure, there should be some truth behind that, and currently chain link is pretty easy to defeat. This is what I'm talking about in terms of space standard. This is the image that I opened with, and I said, yeah, this is a really nice facility. It's stuffed full of bikes, so people really like the way that it functions. However, when you look at the amount of space that is unutilized, the entire wall to ceiling above where the bicycle sits is unused currently. And so there are some products that are available to address that. This is another local, I think this is a housing project where they used semi-vertical, which is what we currently allow. The idea is that you put a bike semi-vertically within this tray and then lock it. You will notice, however, every bike in there is using that rack incorrectly. I do not like semi-vertical bike parking. I do not think that it's intuitive. I don't think people use it correctly, and I don't think it's what we need long-term as a solution. But there are a number of products out there that work better. Stacked bike parking, for example, uses all of that space above the existing space and gives you enough space in between so that you can comfortably put a bike on it. We hear from people that say, well, I can't lift my bike up that high. A lot of these products don't require you to do that. They use a pneumatic or like a other type of assistance assistance device to actually, you pull this whole tray out, it comes down, you load the bike onto it, and then the assistance lifts the bike up and then it slides back in. So this would be one way to better utilize floor space.
Do you have an idea how much that costs?
Those are a little pricey.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, it depends on the manufacturer. But, so, for example, where in the old format you would put the floor-mounted bikes in a space this big, if you can stack that, you've just increased this much leasable space. So you can probably do an ROI on that and figure out that this is probably a better long-term solution.
It's less space,
right,
but more expensive.
Yeah. Yeah, and so, you know, I'll get into some other best practice around that, but I also like vertical parking or the spaces that are hung, and we have some examples around town when we used to allow this that were built that I think this can be very space efficient. The issue here is that you can only do a small percentage of this because this does require you to lift the bike up off the ground. So we would only want a certain percentage of this in your long-term bike parking, and the rest of it would need to be floor mounted so that people could access that space efficiently. This is a little dark, but you'll see that they're stacked on the left side. So they've said, well, let's increase our quantity by going up, so we don't have to increase our footprint. And then over on the right side, everything is floor mounted. And I think this is the type of ratio discussions we need to have. So if we are hanging bikes, how many of them? If we are stacking bikes, how many of them? And how many do we need to just be more universally accessible to people? So that's an important discussion as well. One of the deficiencies in our current code is if you build a multifamily development, you're not required to install short-term bike parking. So this is an area where I think we do need more guidance because if you have a friend who comes over by bike, like they're generally locking to trees and to signs and to other things. And so just a quantity of short-term bike parking I think is the best option. Percentage of spaces for family bikes, and this is kind of an extreme example, but there's really only one bike here. This woman is Emily Finch. She lives in Portland, and she does carry all of those kids every day to school, so that's like a real thing. But mostly the point I wanted to make was, and this is a Bachfietz bike, by the way, is that those bikes are a little longer, they're a little wider, and they're not really going to fit in stacked parking. You're not going to be able to hang this, and you're not going to be able to fit it in a traditional bike space that's 6 feet by 2 feet. You're going to need a little bit bigger space for that. And so looking at, a percentage of that in places where we would expect this to occur, like schools, like multifamily developments, and again, I don't know what the percentage is, but it's probably pretty low, but where we expect people to use bikes as their family conveyance, you know, we need to have a place for them to store it securely long term. The other emerging thing here is the growth of e-bikes or electronic assist bikes. They're the fastest growing market. China is overrun with them. Europe is having more and more of them, and the United States is now just catching on. The technology is getting a little cheaper, and so it's more accessible to a wider range of people, and people who ride an e-bike get it almost immediately. You put in so much energy, you get so much output, you can go faster, longer, farther. All of that makes a lot of sense to a lot of people, and especially when you're looking at those family-style bikes where you're hauling another person with you, it can really make that seem like a really viable option because it doesn't feel that much harder to do that. So this is something we need to look at. And again, those bikes don't look much different necessarily, although you can affix an electric motor on any kind of bike, but you know, generally they're out there now. Like, I see them almost every day. We changed the code about a year and a half ago to allow e-bikes on the shared use pass system because previously they were not allowed and they were already operating there, so that's not a big change. But the big change might be if we have a long-term secure bike parking space in a multifamily development where we expect long tail or family bikes to exist that use e-assist, we need to provide them some level of electricity so that they can plug that bike in where we store the bike. Otherwise, they're going to have to run an extension cord or they're going to have to wheel the bike into their house. We ran into this problem. This is a picture of the bike cage where I park every day at work. We purchased an e-bike for public works engineering and did not have any place to plug it in when we put it in that cage. So we did have to wire some electricity to it. And that's something we should think about. Again, I think there's a small percentage here that we're talking about, but it's a level of accommodation that can really make or break a space in terms of viability for families. And then we talked a little bit about this, I think, in the strip mall discussion, but proximity of parking to entrances. And this, the red circle there is where the long-term bike parking is in this development. You know, and if you live over here, and your long-term bike parking is over here, you might be willing to walk that trip, but more than likely you're going to wheel your bike right into your unit and put it somewhere. And so that has some durability issues with carpets and other things that exist in these developments. And so making sure that we have this type of accommodation around the facility would be a little bit more user-friendly. And then locking. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention that because we have experience in our, I live in Western University neighborhood, and Gordon Anslow, on a number of his developments, right at the entrance, he widened it enough that you could usually park a couple of bicycles once you get inside. So right inside the door, there's like a little widened space that that's designed really to park bicycles or carts or something else. So, again, that's not something that you could require, but you certainly could consider that safe for your design handbook for the Envision Eugene, or you could certainly mention it in your in the preface to these new guidelines. That's another possibility.
One of the other things I've noticed, and I don't have the before picture, but we do a lot of long-term bicycle enclosures using like a padlock-style lock. And so, each if you're going to use like a bike locker, each door has a key. Every door that you have to manage means that that bicycle parking is that much more difficult to access. We would advocate, and the best practice would be to build larger secure biking parking structures with a more unified locking device that uses a cipher lock. So either code activated, using some type of a multifunctional ID card is a better way to build that structure, and you're going to find that more people use it and it's easier to manage. So that's something that we recommend quite often. And then this is an example of those bike parking lockers. Which we use quite a bit, I notice, for the requirement for long-term bike parking. An emerging standard would be to use, again, more of a wire mesh product for the walls so that you can see inside of that locker to see what's going on in there. And there's a couple of reasons for that. One of them is Homeland Security standards, especially around like transit stations, is they want to know what's in there because you could get a lot of stuff in there. Another one is from a management perspective. Are people actually storing bikes in there? Are they storing junk? What else is going in there and how is it being used? And then lastly, people may be renting a locker and then never using that locker. So it's nice to know just on a casual inspection what the utilization of that locker actually is. I know the small availability of lockers that we manage downtown through parking services all have contracts, monthly contracts, and we're not really sure how many bikes are actually going into them or not. And so, you know, that either speaks to the price, you know, it's too low, so people just hang on to them just in case, or it also speaks to the availability and that we don't have a lot of them. People would like more of them, but part of our issue has been management. And these are actually interesting. I think these are part of the BART system in California. Is they, you can't really see it, but they use an electric RFID card, and then you actually pay into the service. It's like an hourly fee where you can use this. Anybody could use this who's a member and has the access card. So it's a really nice way to provide long-term secure bike parking in places where you might not have the ability to develop it structurally within the building. So that's basically what I had. I wanted to just touch on the concepts of bike parking and what we're thinking about for best management practices. Some staff and I have started to go through the code and identified places where we think we could make some of these improvements, and we'll have draft language for you to look at. Some of that advice comes from the Bicycle and Pedestrian Master Plan, which was prepared, where the consultant said you need to update your bike parking code. We also did a specific regional bike parking study to figure out where these larger bike cages might exist. So that people who work downtown, we get calls from like the DAC, for example, all the time because they don't have any secure long-term bike parking. Where can I put my bike because I work here all day and I don't want to keep it out on the street all day? So we can figure out where these larger cages exist. It would really help out for people who want to ride to work every day, but then have some, I keep using anxiety, but that's what it boils down to, about leaving their bike outside every day. So we commissioned that plan, and again, the consultant said, well, you need to look at your code because it's out of balance with what your goals are. And so our intent would be to come back as soon as we can with some language changes and discuss what we think, how we think we can tweak the code to match some of these conditions.
I have a question. I guess, what is the current either code or policy as far as short-term bicycle parking in the public right-of-way? Let's see, on sidewalks, I know there's some, I think, out in front of Barn Light and some different areas around town. Is that something the city puts in? And if there is a business, let's say, who has a wide sidewalk that might want some, how would they go about requesting that, or is that even...
Yeah, if bike parking goes in the public right-of-way, we require a permit for that, and then we'll inspect to see if there's space to put them in. Any business, regardless of where they are required to provide bike parking, and so we try to find a space to do that. Downtown can be challenging because all that space might be used by planter boxes or by other street furniture, and so there might not be the available space to do that. And so that's one of the reasons, you know, staff has been having a discussion about downtown and how downtown bike parking gets managed. We've talked about, you know, and I use the DAC as an example, they don't have any room to build long-term bike parking there. So where would the locations be where we could potentially do some long-term secure? And then are there constellations where we would do some short-term so that we could manage that better and make sure that every block face has at least one or two racks? So if a new business goes in there, they don't have to worry about, well, do I have room on my sidewalk to put this in? We've already thought about that and identified the places where we have enough space to do that. In the regional bike parking study, which is available on our website, I think I linked to it maybe in the memo, is this report, and it actually draws a map of downtown and then color codes each block face by how many rack elements there should be per block face, for example. And I think that's a really good way to do it. A recent example of where we don't have any racks is a yoga place just went up at 245 East Broadway. That block has no bike parking at all. And there still isn't any because we can figure out how to get the racks on the sidewalk there because it's a 9-foot sidewalk. But we decided as a city that we're going to rebalance some of our racks and find a way to put some in that block. And I think it's a better way to do it in downtown would be for staff to identify where the best places are for just in terms of spacing. But the long term, I think it's still something we need to reconcile. And so that's going to be a conversation.
Mr. Baker.
Yeah, I just wanted to bring back a point that you mentioned, but just somehow, you know, given our weather, particularly for 6 months of the year, covered bike parking is really attractive for two reasons. One, your seat isn't totally soaked and your bicycle's not totally soaked, but also means the time it takes to get unlocked and get your bicycle ready to go, you're not standing around in the rain. So I just don't know what I know it's not required for short-term parking, but again, that's certainly something to consider, some requirement for certain a number of them to be covered spaces, and then trying to figure out cost-effective and attractive ways to do that. You know, that's one of the problems downtown is there's really not very much covered. You know, there's a lot of, as Commissioner Randall has discussed, there's a lot of parking in the public right-of-way, but there's very little covered parking. So, you know, your choice is to park conveniently in a place where it's visible and it's, your bicycle is more likely to be there when you come back and get it. Or you can find us a few covered parking spaces, but they're in more iffy places in terms of leaving your bicycle for a period of time and being able to find your bike. A good example of a situation that works is the library has developed those canopies and then the other canopy in the public right-of-way that provide bicycle parking, and then there are some spaces that aren't covered, but that's one of the few examples in downtown where there's, and actually out in front here, there's a few spaces here, But, you know, this is the same location as the library, but most of the other parts of downtown are not covered, and neither are, you know, a lot of the larger stores that people make use of.
Yep.
Mr. Borowski.
And just to kind of dovetail on that, you mentioned that right now there is no requirements for multifamily housings, and that's one area that we're looking into. I'm just wondering if there is, if maybe we want to look into what the other people were talking about, you know, can we use maybe the special setback areas if it's covered, you know? I don't want to use the word amenity again, but I think a covered parking would be an amenity, I think, you know. Are there trade-offs that we want to do? Can it be part of the open, is bicycle parking, could that be considered part of the open space requirements? Is it part of the, you know, could it be in the special setbacks? Has that discussion come up? Because if we don't have it now and we're going to try and implement it, and we just got through going through a whole bunch of all the requirements on South Willamette as far as what, you know, you need to have this much space for this and this and this, and now we're going to put in this as another thing that we need to put in there. Can that work in dovetail? I'm just wondering if you guys have discussed that with planning as far as the zoning.
We have not, but I just wrote it down.
Okay.
I did, too. I put a little box around it. So.
Yeah. I mean, for me,
that's good.
If, you know, if there's a planter box or there's a cover, you know, which, you know, or a planting, which is allowed in a special setback, you know, I would trade that off for a covered bicycle parking in a special setback. I don't know if that's something that the community is tolerant of or not, but I think it's a good question to ask.
Mr. Nicolello.
Yeah, actually, kind of following up on the discussion with that Commissioners Baker and Brofsky brought up, I'm actually kind of curious what accommodations may need to be made in the code for bike share that's going to be coming up, especially in a downtown area where I imagine a lot of these bike share stations are going to be concentrated. So I don't know if that's is that something that's relevant to the conversation we're having about code right now, or any accommodations need to be made for that?
It's a good question. You know, we've been thinking about how bike share might be part of the review process in terms of maybe a transportation demand management plan. Maybe if you had bike share, you wouldn't need as many automobile parking spaces, for example, if you developed a TDM that spoke specifically about that. We haven't gotten into that level of discussion yet. There's a couple of things at play. One of them is we don't know what type of bike share system we're going to get, if it's going to be station-based or if it's going to be more of a smart bike that can live at different bike racks. Certainly, if it's a bike that can travel, then we're going to need secure bike parking at a variety of different destinations that will accommodate that bike share bike. So we are thinking about that right now. I don't think I have any good answers for it.
And I think for the benefit of the audience and those who may be watching, can you clarify what bike share is and what the City of Eugene is doing with that? Just, I know it's kind of a more jargony.
Yeah, so bike share is a transportation solution that allows people to use bikes as transit for short trips, usually 30 minutes or less. You can either walk up to a bike share bike or station and use a credit card to check out a bike, or you can be an annual member where you would have some kind of a key fob where you could swipe or check out a bike. Generally speaking, they work well with transit. We try to pair them with where transit stations exist to solve part of the first mile, last mile transportation issue, how do I get from the station to my workplace, that sort of thing. Bikes can be really handy for that. And, you know, the other thing is, especially with transit, is there are a lot of lines now on our BRT, like from downtown to campus, that are really full. And so identifying transportation alternatives so that people can use the type of mode that they prefer. So we know that a lot of people at the university ride bikes, so providing them bikes to get from downtown to the campus seems like a really natural fit. But then there are also two different technologies of bike share bikes. They're the type of bikes that live in a station, and the station has all the technology for transactions. It's also how the bike gets locked up. It gets locked up at a station. There's also the type of bike share bike where all of that technology for transactions lives on the bike itself, and those bikes can kind of go anywhere. But you generally incentivize bikes to come back to a station by charging them fees for out-of-service lockups. But it might be worth it to you to have a two-minute penalty or $2 penalty so that you can go park at the restaurant that you want or go to the grocery store that you want. And that's where it's particularly important that we have secure bike parking at those destinations so our bike share bikes don't disappear. And then so we have currently through Connect Oregon about $900,000 to purchase equipment. The University of Oregon a couple years ago had $200,000 to build a bike share. They're going to sign that over to the city. We're currently working with LTD and the university to develop a system-wide, citywide program that goes from the university to downtown to the Whittaker area. And we have about $1.3 million, I think, total for that. And so right now, we performed a feasibility study. Right now, we're looking at getting sponsorship. And we're going to have an RFP for vendor solicitation out in the next 2 months or so to see what we can get. And based on what we get back, we're either going to end up with docks or we're going to end up with smart bikes, and we'll figure out that whole package when we get the bids back. So it's an exciting time. It's more bikes, but it also means that we've got more requirements on the system potentially, and some of that related specifically to bike parking.
Commissioner Jaworski.
Yeah, I'd like to follow up on a comment you made and what Commissioner Borowski said. You made a comment that you were looking for places, but it was very difficult to find where to build some of these structures because there isn't space. Mm-hmm. And Commissioner Borowski talked about setbacks. My comment is along those same lines, but a concern that if you're working with the existing code, if I remember correctly, even on the eWeb downtown river site, we approved some sidewalks 6 feet or less. So what we're saying is there's never going to be any bike parking available down there. I would think that you would be taking a look at what the code says now for when we have these sidewalks being built, that what we're saying is we're never going to find a place for these bikes because we're building them too not wide enough. That's just a comment.
Mr. Baker.
Yeah, just two things. One is just a suggestion. If you could pass on to the or email to us the link to the draft studies that you talked about here from ABP, or you know, just so we wouldn't have to dig through and find them. And the other question or comment is, you alluded to it earlier, but one of the problems that you have with the bus system is they have a limited capacity to carry someone with their bicycle. And some of those routes it's pretty difficult to be able to get depending on the time of day and certain blocks of hours, you can't really depend on being able to use EMX at all and get your bicycle on. And I assume that there's some of the bus routes that have similar situations as well. So I'm just wondering about what are we thinking about in terms of coordination with the LTD and or other agencies about trying to, I mean, obviously if we're expecting to increase the likelihood of bicycles being used, there are certain places where people are going to use public transit to get from here to there, and then they'll use their bicycle for the last mile or two, as you suggest. Mm-hmm. So it just seems like something, it's not directly related to bicycle parking, but it's part of the same limitation or amenity, whatever you want to call it. So just wanted to throw that out.
So this study, LTD was actually the project manager on this study, and the point was where we do have a transit station that serves a lot of boardings and alightings, can we put a bike rack there? Can we put some long-term secure bike parking there? What does that look like? How do we access it? And that's where we're looking at now as a potential grant, is to look at those types of bike parking either lockers or larger units that use like a key code access. One of the manufacturers is called BikeLink, where you actually buy into a system, and with that card you're able to access long-term secure. And LTD would be a major partner in that, especially along MX corridors, where you could leave your bike, especially if you can't bring it on board, where you can leave your bike and feel safe about leaving it there. And so we have had those conversations, and we continue to have them because it is important.
Commissioner Borowski.
I'm just going to bring up another thing. In regards to the longer and wider bikes, this is, you know, I see that, yes, this is an area that we may be, you know, some bikes are getting longer, some bikes are getting wider. And I'm just going to use an analogy, comparing it to vehicle parking. Okay, so I'm required to provide parking, a certain number of parking spaces, okay? But I don't have to require recreational vehicle parking spaces, you know? So if somebody chooses to drive an RV, and I want to cater to people who drive RVs, then I would put in an RV parking spot in my establishment. Or if I think that people who drive recreational vehicles are somebody that I want to bring in, as a business owner, I would accommodate those people. And I think that because people are driving larger bicycles, maybe instead of us saying you've got to have so many spaces that fit a 9-foot bicycle as opposed to a 6-foot bicycle, maybe let the market drive that in the near future. Just as if I were trying to have a business that caters to families or people who are going to drive larger bicycles, it would be in my best interest to have a certain percentage of my bike parking that could accommodate those. But to be mandated to have that where maybe I'm not going to, they're not going to be used, I don't know. You know, are we going to go to, in our parking requirements, am I going to have parking for oversized vehicles? And, you know, I don't want to be at the stick in the mud here, but I also want to have a little bit of market-driven common sense, too. Because if you're saying I've got to have larger spaces for larger bicycles, well then, correspondingly, do I have to have larger spaces for larger motor vehicles?
Would it be okay if I jumped in and just said, yeah? Rob Bitterfeld, Transportation Planning Manager.
I just think it's worth pointing out that we have a draft TSP right now that has a goal of doubling the number of bicycling trips maybe over the next 20 years.
TSP.
Okay, but so I just wanted to point that out. I think when Reed comes back, he'll point out some of the larger goals. Mm-hmm. And then you heard from, gosh, I think it was earlier on when we were starting to talk about South of Lamont Street, you heard from Matt McRae about the climate recovery ordinance. And so we're given some pretty aggressive goals that we need to meet in terms of how do we reduce greenhouse gas emissions from transportation. Okay. And so what we're looking at is how do we create a city where it's easy for people to get around by biking for all kinds of people, including families. And what we're seeing over the last several years is a lot more family biking on these larger bikes. But if we want to, you know, we're looking at having more multifamily housing in Eugene too. Some of that housing is going to be family housing, and we're looking to accommodate more families who are biking because that's how we're going to meet our goals. That's in the draft TSP and our charge from the climate recovery ordinance of, you know, drastically reducing our greenhouse gas emissions from transportation. So this is really part of that larger vision.
Sure. Okay, then, and that's fine. That's why I wanted to hear the, you know, the rationalization behind it.
Well, thank you, Reed. Appreciate the update and the input.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Brings us to items from staff.
Just a quick reminder of elections next Monday. Assuming you're I'm soliciting input from the other commissioners. Okay.
Talking to and calling people.
So okay, terrific.
Actually, it'll probably be email because I don't think I have people's phone numbers.
Okay. So folks could get back to Commissioner Randall. That'd be great. The work plan, the draft work plan for the preview next week is in the works. We'll be pulling that together this week and hopefully sending that out to you in your packet, along with a little bit of context. We also want to consider, of course, the commission or the subcommittee appointments. So I believe I forwarded that out as well, so we can be looking at that. I think there may be some other subcommittees that we want to look at or other appointments that are not on there.
I didn't see that yet.
Last week sometime.
Yeah, I think sent it out last week. Yeah, I think it was shortly after the last meeting. Okay.
Came from Robin.
Okay.
So that is about it. We could also... we could also discuss, if we have time, any items of interest from commissioners about what you want to do with a retreat, if we want to have one of those coming up. And, of course, any conversations. I know Commissioner Nicolello forwarded out an email to me with some interest in some training and just kind of basic stuff that I think some of you probably know, but it's always a good reminder, and also for any new commissioners, be super helpful. So again, we're looking at that for the 24th. We can also bring up any of those questions next week. Should have plenty of time for that.
All right.
Cool.
Items from commission.
Oh, I had one question, and then okay, just a question. You sent us to committees. Are we supposed to send back to you committees we'd like to be on? What do we do? Just look at it? Where does that stand?
Thanks. I would say go ahead and would it be all right, Commissioner Randall, for them to send that to you as well?
Sure.
Okay. Or does it make sense for go ahead and send them to me? How about that?
I'm exiting after next week.
That's right. You're exiting.
So.
All right. So why doesn't, just to be clear, anybody who has interest on the subcommittees, go ahead and send that information to me, and I'll collect that and provide that back to everybody on Monday next week.
We can sort through that.
And will you be adding, like, new potential committees based on the work program? Because some of those are sort of past, and I'm sure there's new ones that maybe should have been added.
Yeah, I think we'll definitely have to consider that as the time comes when new work items emerge and become real and live. So we can consider that as an as-needed basis. It's not, we don't just have to address this once a year. I think we'll get it lined out to the extent we can, and then, I think...
So items from commission, I've got...
Just a question.
Questions.
My question is just, is there a number of subcommittees that we are required to serve on? I noticed that Rick served on 8, and he is definitely a superstar. But how many should we be serving on?
I don't think there's any official minimum. It's just whatever.
Most people are serving like on between 3 and 5, I think, assignments. If you look at the bottom of it, it'll give you distribution. That's kind of a best clue to, so the ones that are the highest interest would get your name in for quickly as possible.
Yeah, I think whatever you have time and the ability to cover reasonably,
Okay. Mr. Baker?
Just a comment suggestion.
Sure.
In the past, we'd had training associated with that APA conference in September, because there's usually some kind of training for planning commissioners that's generally offered. I just mentioned that to our new commissioner because maybe that would be something that the staff could explore and see if that's available. That might be a way for Commissioner Taylor and Commissioner Nicolello to, you know, be allowed to take one of those.
Yeah, absolutely. The conference, I believe, is usually in the We used to have an Oregon APA conference, which I don't believe
Oregon APA is in October in Portland.
Okay.
The OPI, Oregon Planning Institute, doesn't exist anymore, but a Eugene training is shifting to the spring time frame, and so we actually did hold one in May at the university, and that one's passed, but the upcoming conference in Portland in October may have a planning commissioner training associated with it.
Yes, and I'll be there anyways for work, so I don't see why we couldn't tack something on.
Yeah, so we can talk more about training as well.
Excellent.
Commissioner Borowski, then Commissioner Mill.
A couple of things. So the email was on July 27th from Rob, just for information.
You.
At least that's when it hit my box. Also, for me, it would be, and I don't know how the rest of the commissioner feel about this, but Commissioner Randall mentioned that, you know, he would have to reach out by email. I would be comfortable with a phone list of commissioners so that if I wanted to pick up the phone and call Bill or any of the other commissioners, I would like to have that contact information. If you didn't feel like comfortable with giving them, I would understand that, but I would think that would be something that would be advantageous. I don't know how the rest of the other commission feels about that, but for me, email's nice, but it's I'm a voice and even a landline type of a person, you know, that likes to I can get a lot more done in a 5-minute conversation on a phone than 14 emails back and forth, and that's just me.
And I have no problem. I mean, all my phone numbers are on my business card, so it's.
I have no problem.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's
so maybe
idea.
If we could get one of those sent out.
Sure.
Or
that would be nice because I feel like my. Contacting because I see you all once a week usually,
right.
And to have an opportunity to ask you privately,
mm-hmm.
you know, your interest is a little difficult, and then to not have phone numbers and to do it by email seems impersonal. Yeah,
I was just going to add, we used to have a mailing list like that we used to ship out. It's been a year or two before since we've done
it. It was in the front of that notebook.
Yeah, I believe we do actually have a roster because having looked at it just recently, it seems like everybody's phone number is on there. So maybe it's just a matter of sending that out to make sure everybody has it.
Just send it out. Just make sure it's updated and send it out. Yeah.
Okay.
So you'll be getting a phone call from me instead of an email.
Cool.
Which is better anyway.
I like that.
Yeah. Okay. Other items from commission? Going over time, but go ahead.
Yeah, I had just a follow-up. I don't know if you were at that public hearing, Rob, or whatever, but it was addressed at the public hearing that some of the things that are said in the pre-announcing of the meeting and whatever, they didn't understand. And there was I know some of that might be legally written, but if there was a way to make that more user-friendly was what the public was asking because they didn't quite understand when something would be told them about the public hearing process. I just sort of a follow-up on that, see if it, A, can be done, and B, you know, suggested wording to make it more user-friendly.
Mm-hmm. Good comment. Okay. Yeah.
Commissioner Mills.
Just a reminder, I'm not here next Monday.
Okay. Commissioner Borowski.
And I've just got a question as far as the TRG. Is there going to be a meeting of that before next week? And is Rick going to stay on as a member of the TRG?
He has agreed to do that, but the TRG
needs a representative from here.
Well, and it's shifting its role, so we can have that conversation next week as part of the subcommittee assignments.
Mm-hmm.
When you heard the monitoring update, you heard about a technical advisory committee.
Mm-hmm.
If the TRG continues, it would meet much, much less frequently because most of the work it had been doing would be subsumed by the Technical Advisory Committee.
All right. Commissioner Baker.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm going to be out on the 30th as well. I think I mentioned that to Amy, but I wanted to make sure that.
Okay.
And the other thing that I'd like to just throw out to maybe some future discussion is we're not required to close comments when we're not doing a quasi-judicial. So when we're doing legislative, like we were doing with South Willamette, there were a number of times we had a lot of people here that some of them wanted to speak,
So I'd like to come back and at least revisit the our concept of public participation. We might want to reconsider that in cases when we're doing legislative, we will accept, 10-minute, some 10, 12, 15, whatever we decide of public comments, so that when people make an effort to come out here, that they have an ability to at least, feel like that they had a chance to say something.
That's a real good idea.
I'll definitely take note of that. I think we ought to put that in the bin for the training conversation, so we can really explore some of those questions and figure out what to do.
Just a quick, and this is, so UGB expansion for residential subcommittee, that will go away because we're not going to be expanding it.
Yeah, but we'll get to have one on urban reserves. So
there you go.
So when you're looking at that one, don't put your name up for UGB. Any other ones on here that you can think of that are going away, so if we're sending them in? So I've got sustainability, I'll just read them off. Sustainability Commission.
That's sticking around.
Human Rights Commission, Housing Policy Board. Then there were Project Specific Committee, Transportation Community Resource Group, Technical Resource Group, Key Corridor Study. And that one has nobody on it. I don't know.
Oh, that's moving ahead. Okay. That's been renamed.
UGB Expansion for Residential, that goes away. UGB Expansion for Employment in Public Land stays, right? Monitoring Program, South Willamette Area Planning, that stay or go?
Well, assuming we get through the process of adoption with council, I would say that goes.
Okay. Incentives. EE plan, which is the comprehensive plan. And then comprehensive plan diagram. And then community design guide.
I'll stay.
Yeah. Just I wanted to mention, so people don't realize it, forget that one of the challenges with the Housing Policy Board is it meets at the same time as our meeting, mm-hmm. the first Monday of the month, I believe, or the second?
I believe it's the first, and I think what we said we were going to do to try to accommodate that is to not hold Planning Commission meetings the first Monday of the month. We may, given how busy the schedule has been lately, that just hasn't been possible. So we may have to find a better solution. I think we talked about that once.
Right.
Once
so before. Just so people know that's a challenge signing up for.
Yep.
That you may not be able to attend any of their meetings. So.
Okay. We're adjourned.